something inside the church pulled my imagination, my creativity, my sense of adventure, and my powers. The second reason is the geographic structure of the church to have a marketplace. Something outside of the church satisfied my tendencies, my preferences, and my sense of delight. These are the starting point of where I entered the religious life. When I entered the Dominican life, we were told that this is how we are going to follow until we reach the priesthood. This is going to be the road map. At first, we enter into the aspirancy here in Tanambalabi. Aspirancy is good for 2 years. I was told by the director at that time when I was at the office, a first year aspirant, our training is going to be different from the previous trainings of seminarians and even of the Dominicans because we are going to have our classes in the class along with students, boys and girls. When we entered the seminary, there are initial days there, we were hoping that we would be classmates only all of our seminarians and no classmates from the outside. But apparently, the reason was that we changed from the usual, the ordinary of having classmates of the same sex and of different sex, is slow and gradual. So the first 2 years, we had our classmates, female classmates, as well as male classmates, not religious, not seminarians. And then the third year, which is the postulancy, we still are in the Kalambalan time, but we're not anymore taking our classes in the Karatina. So it was a slow change from the usual. In the aspirancy, 2 years there, we finished 265 hours of formal lessons and lectures in math, 197 hours required for the studies of the natural sciences, completed the prescribed 212 hours of classroom lectures in social sciences, 106 hours in Filipino, 370 hours of proficiency in Spanish and Latin, and that language was in Spanish 1 and 2. And then 150 exhausting hours of 3 hours physical training in military science. However, we only had 7 hours of formal discussion of the evangelical concept. 2 years, more than 700 days. Why? Oh, why? So it's 7 hours out of more than 700 days. 700 times 24 hours, that would be more than 14 hours. And yet we only spent 7 hours for the evangelical time. When we proceeded to our postulancy, that's 1 year, again, the Kankalampa, we continued with our 106 hours of Latin studies. We accomplished it for required hours of the studies of the government of the Dominican culture. We completed the prescribed 4 hours of classroom lectures in the rules of St. Augustine because the Dominican was founded following the rules of St. Augustine. At that time, no order was permitted to open unless they follow a certain rule that has already been approved by the church. So, 4 hours of classroom lectures in the rules of St. Augustine. And then there are 42 hours of formal lessons and lectures in speech and drama. And their father's name. We experienced 150 hours of facilitating the feats and recollection. While still in the second year, third year in the seminary, we were already bombarded with assignments of giving or facilitating the feats and recollections for elementary, high school, and sometimes to professionals. Of course, we had priests to accompany us, but more often than that, we were the ones facilitating the recollections and the feats. One reason is course, to remove that inhibition from among us, inside us, We fulfilled the 106 hours of period studies in basic and speed sailing. However, we only had 21 accumulated hours of informal discussions and sharings of the knowledge. Again, we questioned why. Why? Only 21 hours out of 365 days, 12 months, sometimes 11 months because we have to go towards vacation. Then we proceeded to the novitiate. The novitiate is good for 1 year. It is here that we discuss the Evangelical Council of the Spirituality of the Dominicans and the lives of the saints. But then again, looking back, I realized that maybe it was only good for 2 weeks that we discuss the vows of poverty, obedience, and chastity. And then we proceeded to the student day. The student day where we finish our philosophy, theology, licensure in theology, and now also master in IP preaching. Only after that can you be ordained into the priesthood. So the question is, how are the evangelical vows formed in the seminaries of the Dominican? How do the Dominicans understand and give the evangelical council? It is a given that the basic foundation is important. If it is important in the first 2 years, it's what? First two stages, the aspirants in the apostolacy, what is it that we were given only limited hours of discussion of the evangelical council? If the basic foundation of the evangelical council is strong, it is more likely that it will be beneficial to the formandi during this long formation years, eventually throughout this priestly life. I said I was attracted to the being religious and eventually to the religious life because of two structures, the physical structures and structure of the church and the geoeconomic structure outside the church. Then I realized that the reason why very few discussions were held on us regarding the council was because we had to live those evangelical councils, and it is embedded in the social structure of the seminary. It is embedded in the social structure of the seminary. So aside from the physical structure, the geoeconomic, it is the social structure of the seminary that made us more understood the councils. Now the vows are clearly explained to us in the novitiate through our book of constitutions and ordinations of the order of teachers. And from these vows, from this book, oldest book in the order, we define obedience in many ways. And sometimes when we talk about obedience, it is always in relation to freedom. Actually, they say it is not freedom at all, because we give up our personal freedom when we take the vow of obedience. We give up. So it is actually equivalent of giving up freedom. You are told to say what you are to say, you are told to do what you are to do, and you are told to think what you are to think. And there's no freedom there, because you want to speak about this, you want to think about this. I remember when I was taking up theology or philosophy, we had one of our professors, Father Martina, as Spanish Dominican. And I was commenting on our class was in philosophy of communism. And then I was commenting on our formation. I told him that our entrance requirements are very high, and that along the way, in our academic requirements also, we have to maintain more than 83. If you have a grade of 82 and below, then verified mean that you will not see the second semester or the next semester. I remember one of our brothers, our classmates, asked me to visit 81 in 19. And our region of studies was very strict. Even just that thing, he was set up. So I was telling the father, I said, you accepted most of those in my batch. We were, according to our assignment, there were 700 who applied, because that was the time when he was so popular. That 700 of people of us were accepted as first year as firearms coming from all over the Philippines. And almost all were graduated from high school with honors, the victorious of the program, and personal award. And so I was thinking, why not permit us to take up other courses like economics, law, sociology, so that we can speak the language of the people that we are teaching, and not only philosophy and theology and sacred scripture. So that was my greatness. And the good priest said, okay, you go out and go to and enter the Jesuit. So that was his response to me. I always wanted to take up law, but apparently the Vita spirituality at that time, our concept of the Dominican priest is only on philosophy, theology, canon law, and sacred scripture. It was only in the late 90s when we had the shift, when we were being permitted to take up other courses. So obedience apparently is giving up freedom, but is it really giving up personal freedom? And this is very true in the aspiracy. This is very true in the aspiracy. Why? Because in the oratio of the seminary, you could see we wake up and get up at 5:15 a.m. Even if we still want to continue to sleep. We pray the morning prayer aloud and in unison at 5:40 a.m. despite the personal desire to pray in silence, we are giving up something. We attend the mass at 6 a.m., standing, reading, and singing at a prescribed duration, even if we still want to kneel longer. We take up our breakfast, together from 6:35 a.m. to 7 a.m. only, even if we want to extend our morning meals. We wash the dishes from 7 a.m. to 7:15, notwithstanding we still have assignments to complete for our 7:30 a.m. class. We do our toiletries in no more than 5 minutes between 7:15 to 7:25 because we were 45 first year, second year, and foster class. And there were only 6 cubicles. Because there are only 2 shower cubicles. We hurriedly run to our first class of 7:30 a.m. and then to the 8:30, the 9:30, the 10:30, and to the 11:30. Even though we already want to rest. We hurriedly prepare our lunch from 11:45 a.m. to 11:55 a.m. even if we just run out of our classes. In the formation, we are obedient to the rules and to our superiors because, at first, it is something novel, unique, mysterious, and ultimately serves as food to our initial messianic tendencies. When we entered the seminary, the formation house, it was in the guise of living behind the world. Everyone, everything that we love in the world, we live behind. There is some messianic tendency of sacrificing everything. And so, when we are face to face with all these things in the seminary, it was easy at first. Easy at first. Because it was something novel, unique, and mysterious. We give up our habit to keep on playing basketball. what they could be from 4 o'clock to 5:30. There were only two basketball courts and we were 45. So we had to share that. And we wanted to play more because we were young. But we could not because the bell rings at 5:25. So we had to rush to the seminary because again, there were only 6 hour certificates and we were 45. But the thing there is that also in the class, we would control our minds from wandering. When we had classes that extended to 4 o'clock, after some time, we were already jittery. When it's already 4 o'clock, the teacher is not yet dismissed us because 4 o'clock is game time basketball class. We wanted to move out of the classroom, but we cannot. I remember when, during my first days in the seminary, I was lying down while reading the book, and somebody tapped my foot, right foot. So I thought it was one of the seminarians and said, "Oh," and then again, a tap on my left foot. "Oh!" I was reading. And then when I looked into the person, because I was really worried, because no one is permitted to go to bed, you know, at that time. You have to be in the bingo, you have to be in your desk. Only when 10 o'clock, when the bell for 10 o'clock comes, then you can go to bed. We would name our instinct of falling asleep during study time. In the initial stages of our vocation, it feels highly fulfilling to sacrifice and leave behind something we have been used to. Again, at first, because it's something novel, and it serves food to our initial missionary tendencies. But then, afterwards, many grow among us that tendency to follow the rules to give us that personal freedom slides to fear and the rejection of and by. We follow the rules, we obey because of fear. Fear from our superior that we will be called and eventually dismissed. And we reject it also by our brothers because the brothers are following the rules. Why aren't you? When the sense of the mysterious leaves, that's the time when we slide with fear and rejection, but still follow the rules. Then it is because of embarrassment. You don't want to remain in the room. We have one huge room where all of us are there. You don't want to remain there when everyone is in class. You don't want to remain sleeping, but you sleeping when everyone is in that prayer room or in the chapel. It was embarrassment. Embarrassment that pushed us to follow the rules and the spirit, to obey. When boredom, familiarity, and regularity kick in, this embarrassment. And so, we are expected to agree on an action despite our strong opposition. When we have meetings, we don't want that, but we have to agree on that. We let others decide for us. So maybe obedience is equivalent to giving up freedom because we follow because of that. But is it really like that? Is obedience really giving up freedom? We are obedient to the rules and to our spheres because it is something we need. Then it's like Sophia, then we follow because of embarrassment. In obedience, according to the Dominicans, we seek to imitate the love and obedience of Jesus to the Father. The beginning of Jesus' preaching was his proclamation to the fulfillment of Isaiah's promise, freedom for prisoners and liberty for those who are oppressed. So if Jesus came to give us freedom, why is it that there is this vow that somehow limits our freedom? When the disciples found Jesus talking to the Samaritan woman by the way, he says to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me. Thus, the obedience of Jesus to the Father is not a limitation of his freedom, a restriction of his autonomy. It is actually the food that gives him strength and makes him robust. It is his relationship to the Father that gives him all that he is, his very being. This deep freedom of Jesus to belong to the Father. So basically, obedience is belonging to something higher than yourself. This is the model in finding the meaning of how to be free and how to give up. It is not the freedom of buyers or consumers with unrestricted choice to be alternative purchasing. Actually, it is the freedom of the one who loves. So this is supposed to be what we should be developing. In that seminary life, it is the love for Christ, the love for the community, the love for the world. Within the Dominican tradition, this belonging together in which obedience is marked by a tension between two characteristics. An unqualified gift of life to the order, give everything to the order. And a search for consensus based on debate and mutual attentiveness and respect. We have a monthly chapter in the convent, and we discuss things. The idea is, you can say anything that you want there, because we're supposed to be mature. After the meeting in the convent, after the chapter, we're still brothers. We're still brothers. Leave behind whatever is said there, even if it was said in a very violent way. So the thing is, we want this to happen, and yet, after a democratic voting, and then everyone believes that this is the very way, you have to give in. You have to give in. And own the decision of the community. That is something very difficult. Because you could see that this is the right path. And sometimes our brothers, because of their limitations in studies and everything, they could not see that. But once the voting ends, and they believe that their choice is B rather than A, you have to own the B, even if it is not your choice. That is something very difficult. And you cannot complain. You should not complain. And when you go talk to other people, you cannot say, because they chose the B and not the E. You cannot do that because it's still your choice now. Because you gave your will to the community. And it's really very difficult. The vow of obedience for the Dominican has a deep prominent aspect of responsibility, always in the name of the community, more than or aside from the hierarchical or authority dimension. Our provincial, before he gives us the assignment, he always talk to us. What do you think should be your next assignment? But he already has in his paper where we are going to be placed. But he gives us the opportunity to talk. Maybe we can be changed. In obedience, we entrust ourselves to him and to each other. It's the community. It's the community. And that is why, from the very beginning, from aspirancy to postulancy, in our Rancho Formationis Particularis and Generalis, our formation rules, it stipulates there that the first stages of our formation is actually social and communitarian. We're not expected to be so intelligent. We're not expected to be so good in philosophy and theology, because those are only the first two stages. What we are expected of is to be able to have a well-rounded personality where we can relate to people from the north, from the south, even if they speak other languages. even if their culture is very different to mine. It's how you relate to the people. It's the social structure that helps us to develop. In obedience, we seek to live together with the freedom for which Christ has set us free. Mature men capable of sharing in the projects and responsibilities of the community. You know, we have this tempting notion that we can forgive, we can. There is a sense of a leeway in us when some of our brothers would commit mistakes, action problems, and sin against the flesh, might even have a woman. Hopefully not a man. We can even forgive. But when it's about obedience, it's very difficult. When it's about obedience, it's very difficult. We do need judgment, we profess only one vow, and that is obedience. We do not profess chastity or poverty, because we believe that obedience covers these two vows. So even if we do not like our superior, but if the superior says please, and with peace obey, everyone is angry with us. Because we were training to obey. We find our submission, we find our humility there. And so no matter what your reasons are, you will always be strong in our eyes. For the Dominicans, obedience is giving ourselves to the order without conviction. That is why we can elect someone who is not even the most intelligent among us, or who is not even the most kind, the most patient. We have a provincial, very intelligent, really intelligent, but when you go to him and you ask him this, before you can say anything, or just one sentence, he will already tell you that this is wrong, this is right. And almost all of us were getting angry at his actuation because he thinks so fast and he's really that intelligent. But we survived his provincial and we liked him. But we're always humble, at times humiliated. So that is how we respect. The provincial was voted to be accepted by the Holy. Failure to do so means we become really a group of independent individuals who occasionally cooperate. It's not cooperation. If obedience is experienced as taking position of will of the superior without the search for a common mind, then our vow becomes alienating and human. We have issues, we have history, where some of our fathers left us because of obedience. They could not swallow where they were to be placed. We have issues in some of our convents. They would not leave that convent. They would not leave the case. It would be very difficult for them to leave the convent. And we also had experiences where when one brother was transferred to another convent, but he stayed there for a very long time. In just a matter of 1 year and a half, he died. Because he has been with the community for a long time. He felt it was an inhuman thing to do to transfer him. And it would alienate him from the people. It's because he has had his roots there. So the problem of the superior is always to consider the human side of the man's brain. If you're that old, if you're that sick, in our life, these are the three things that the provincial has to consider. Health not only because he could not transfer there, but because of financial reasons. He has to place people in convents who can afford his medicine. because if not, if we just legislate in other areas, it would suffer, and the community would also suffer. The second is, of course, the age. And the third, believe it or not, is community life. Community life. That's the paradox and the contradiction there. We're supposed to live in a community. We're supposed to know the years, to our formation years. We're supposed to be that mature enough to accept the different attitudes, motivation, and even the character of our families. But every once in a while, we fail. And that is the saddest thing that can ever happen to a priest among us. When he is transferred, and the provincial goes to the convent and tells the convent and the prior to the brothers that I will be transferring this father to your convent. And the father said that convent will say, please do not. Please do not. That's the saddest part of our life. And it happens. It happens. On the part of the one praying, it should not be a way of hiding from the challenges of decision making. Because sometimes obedience bars us from having that responsibility of being the one who decided this. We would always say, community that decides, community that decides. It becomes an excuse when it should not. Again, on the part of the one who believes, it can never be an acceptable excuse of immobility and irresponsibility. Because if you don't decide, you don't do. The social structure that Dominicans here, from aspirancy to the postulancy to the bishops to the lay to the priesthood, have strengthened the following of the vows: the physical structure, the geoeconomic structure, and the social structure. Ultimately, it is not giving up our freedom. It is to belong to the community, to belong to God. And the best community of all is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Trinity. It is to belong to the Father just like what Jesus did, to belong to the Father. The second reason for obedience is to be united, to listen, to be united. We're always told that obedience fundamentally is not fundamentally the submission to the will. It is an expression of our fraternity to each other. The shared life within the order, it is based on dialogue and discussion. The word obedire comes from op audire, to listen. Obedience has a good word of obey, listening. The beginning of true obedience is when we dare to let our brother speak and we listen to them. Even if we don't want to. It is the principle of unity. We grow as human beings by being attentive to others. My classmate, Father Roy, Kanwondo, USB, whenever we would come together, then we would tell stories to each other. And sometimes when I talk about my experience in Indonesia, I was assigned for 6 years, he would stay silent and would act like that. Would do that in my face. Ganyan ka na po, ganyan na, ganyan na. Ibig sabihin nung paulit-ulit yung kwento ko, ganyan ka na po, ganyan na. But he listened to me. He listened to me before he did that. Listening requires all our attention, complete receptivity. The model for this is that of Mary, when Mary listened to the angel. And listening demands intelligent reasoning, meaning to say, you have to ask. You have to assess yourself. And that's why Mary, when she said, how can it be? How can it be? I know that man. This is listening that demands using our intelligence. In the Dominican order, we use our reason not so as to dominate the other, but so as to draw near to them. Many, many years ago, the condition was different. We were the vanguard of the Catholic faith. In fact, yung nagsulubi ang Catholic Church. lagi na ating ganyan. Dumating ang panahon na naisip namin hindi dapat ganun. Kaya very, very limited people or mandatory for the whole class would do an exchange or debate with the Iglesia de Cristo, with others, even with the Muslim. Because we're not into proving that they are wrong. We went to Indonesia in a mission when I was told, you go to Indonesia, and I was oriented, said, you go there, you know, and you will stay there, and you will have this orientation in mind. You're not going there to save them or to convert these Muslims. You have to go there to see and discover the beauty of their religion. One, because Christ has done it before you. You are not the Messiah. You are not the Messiah. Before missionaries would go to mission land, convert people, because they have this thinking of they're bringing along with them the whole truth, and that only their truth can save people. Nowadays, the missionary information is, we see also the beauty in them. If they're going to be converted, they will be converted because they see how we live our religion. It is when they appreciate that, pagano pala ang mga Catholic ko, ganun pala ang mga Catholic ko, willing to be open, willing to accept us, willing to see even our weaknesses and take care of us. It's then that they will be converted and not to make sorrows, proving them that they are wrong. Obedience only becomes perfect when the one who commands and the one who obeys come to share one mind. I remember, you know, in Indonesia, after the Mass, before the end of the Mass, the children will be coming in front of the priest, and the priest is going to bless them one by one. That's the practice there. And most of these kids, they have yaya. Ay, yung mga yaya nila mga Muslim. Nabawal na lang pumasok dito. Nabawal na lang pumasok sa simbahan. Eh, so pagka-less ko na tawag nito ng bata, eh lahat na lang nandiyan dyan, ibe-pesan ko. Di pati yung yaya, pesan ko. Eh, Muslim pala yun. I want, my attention was for what the Muslim was. My attention was for. While we were driving, and then the motorcycle before us slid and bumped into a tree. And I could clearly see, you know, the riders were suffering in pain. Sabi ko sa rider, tingnan mo kasi mamamatay na, bibigyan ko naman. Eh, sabi sa akin ng rider, wow, matay ba? Muslim na lang. Kasi pag yan namatay, ikaw may kasalanan. Paano mo nga naman yung mga mahimugan yung klase ng tao? Sabi na sa kanila, kapag linis mo ang pagkain, so linis ng tayo ang pagkain, hindi na nila kakainis. Whenever I go back to Indonesia, kasi ang nangyayari, pagpapasok ako doon, na ako pag nakita nila ang pare, ang katoliko ko, nadali natin ang katoliko ko sa yung mga polis ng airport. Dali ka dyan. Iiwalay ka. Tapos doon ka lang sasabihin. Wala namang gagawin sa'yo. Hindi ka kapag sa akin. Hindi ka sasabihin kung kapabalik mo. Gusto lang nila yung pakikita. Ikaw ay unlearned nila. So, kapag ako'y nagpupunta doon, yung passport ko wala nito. Walang pache. At nakasure na lang ako. Hindi ako pwede mo. Pwede ka. How can you convert them? How can you listen to them? Nung simbahan namin, yun yung simbahan na pinagbigyan ng Obispo na magpisa ng Iglesias. The only church in Surabaya, or it is by the bishop, to have a mass. And so most of the meat people in Santa Maria and the Jesuits were having their Sunday masses there. And it became very popular. More than 80% of the rich people in Surabaya ay kanilang sa mga English masses na. E mas tapong pa lang ng isang magagandang rumay na magpatay na sila. Every Christmas time, when I was there, we would always receive threats from the ISIS. Of all the churches in Indonesia, kami lang binibigyan ng ganun threats. Kumanda kayo. Pag Christmas, kumanda kayo ng dahil paparating lang niya. Kaya nung nandun ako sa Indonesia, lagi yung nasa wak na may ito, kapag ako yung nabigay ng kumunyo, yung susunod na bibigyan ko na kumunyo, ito pa mamaya, meron ako yung saksakin, kaya yung trip ko sa kumunyo, kaya ako pabagsak. So, hindi mo kaya naalim. Because it happened several times in some churches there. Nag-homemade yung dumating sa Muslim. Pero napakinaki yung pati. Good lang yung pati, yung may gamit yung pala yung sacramental. Yun yung pinag-alaman. So, lagi at gano'n. Ano mo makikipag-engage doon sa mga tatang yun? How do you listen to them? Nonsense. Nagpapakuha kami ng building, nagpapakuha yung Facebook ng building para sa eskwela ka. Ako'y pinadala ko para tulong ng eskwela nila. Noong, kasi bawal na magtayo ng parish. Bawal na, nagdagay sila ng church, parish church, nagdagay sila ng room. Sabi niya, pag nagpapayo pa ng simbahan, dapat yung 200 liters, 2 kilometer area, kukuha lang ng survey at wala dapat mag-reklamo. Eh, kung Muslim yun, siyempre mag-reklamo. Kaya wala na. So, ang ginawa ngayon, edi yung mga existing schools na lang, pagpagawa tayo na chapter door, eh, pinabangon din, gumawa sila. O, edi si James, consequent school na lang. Tapos, ikagawin natin so, inaasahan para pag-correct sa ulit. Nung nakita yun sa plano, okay, gumawa sila ng bago doon. Ang lahat ng classroom, lahat ng ceiling ng isang school, ay dapat hanggang dito lang ang taas. Inagawa na namin, so ulit ko eh. Nung nababa na naman yun, biglang binigyan ang kapitang notice. Hindi pwede magpatay yung magbibigyan kapag ka malapit sa airport. 7 kilometers away from the airport. At meron din dito na mas mataas pa sa amin. Dating kita na lang. So, when you're persecution, how did you please it do that? It happens in a community. Even in that community, there are people who are so illogical. So illogical. Not only in schools, but also in a very old community. Who seem to see all the negative things in the community. From the beginning until the end. Yun lang ang kanilang anak. Bro, so how can you live with people like that? How would you listen? Intelligent. The notion of blind obedience makes no more sense than the blind learning. A totally obedient community would be one in which no one has ever compelled to do anything. Union and everyone does it, even if you don't tell them to. That is the best community. Obedience is not the flight from responsibility. Obedience demands that we catch the responsibility that is ours. Otherwise, we shall never respond to someone else of the church. To belong to the Father, to listen to me united, to give oneself totally and not to bargain. Bargaining happens usually when the change of assignment comes in. Pwede ba huwag na dito? Pwede ba dito na ako? Pwede ba huwag siya kasama ko? Pwede big deal sa akin. Ewan ko sa Taizing San, pero sa akin yung big deal yan. Sabi nung paikita ko yung Taizing San, classmate ko sa concert na yun. You have the vows. You take the vows of obedience, chastity, and power. But we practice it. We take the vows, then we just take the vows. But we practice it. Sabi niya. Kasi siguro ko sa kanya ni Francis eh, talagang lipa, talagang pwesto. When I was in Aquinas University, I was assigned there for 5 years. Every year,